wonderful.
Fabulous. Fabulous evening.
I come to Europeans in Naples because this is where everything is happening culturally. To get a chance to see some of the most wonderful, wonderful musicians, and also on the most beautiful piano that I have ever heard in my life. And I am musically involved, certainly not as much as you are. Lovely people, lovely, lovely concerts, and a wonderful venue. If you don't know what you're missing, you haven't been.
Okay, so how was your experience? Why are you here, first of all?
I'm Milana's student, and I came because she asked me to.
No way!
No!
I don't want that.
I came because I love fresh piano music. Piano music I've never heard before, by performers I've never heard before, and Stephen Beck absolutely blew me away. Just such an joy to see him play, and to see such great musicians play that I never see, ever. So.
It was fantastic. I mean, Steve obviously is amazing, but I've attended a lot of concerts, but this piano is absolutely stunning. And you know, to sit so close to it and experience this, it was fascinating.
So glad to be here.
That was a fantastic concert. That may be one of the best concerts I've heard all year. He is such a wonderful artist. I just wish it was possible for more people to hear him. We need to have a Hayes Hall, at least 1,500 people to listen to this concert. We are tonight.
Tell me what you thought of tonight.
I was so pleased beyond belief. We dreamt up this series. I knew it would be good, but to have Rachel start us off on the highest note possible, I'm still ecstatic about it. And being a supporter and a founder, gee, this was a super night. And I think all the remaining concerts will be super. And we're looking forward to increasing our audience, which I think we will. I think we will, that's for sure. I know where I live, I'll put up information, and I'm going to haul them kicking and screaming.
Love it. Thank you.
You're very welcome. musicians coming from any other country except England and the United States. Later on, we got the Russians to let us have somebody, and so on. We never had a winner that was notable on the American side until Murray Pariah came. You may have heard of him. Now, Drew played at the piano competition, last competition, and he practiced at my house. And if I tell you that I'm sticking my neck out to bring a guy here who is so fabulous, you're listening to somebody who is at the beginning of his career. So you'll be able to tell everybody, yes, I remember Drew Peterson when he was only 23, and he's going to be famous. So enjoy something special tonight.
Thank you. So, there are a couple of important differences in construction, and the construction aspect, of course, then have aesthetic ramifications. So, between these two instruments, and in fact today, I mean, it's absolutely amazing, we have almost all of the different kinds of keyboard instruments. We have the modern piano, we have sort of the missing link in between that you don't see so often. We have the Baroque predecessor, we have the harpsichord, and of course we have the granddaddy of all keyboard instruments, the organ. Now, if we were just speaking about these two, which are pianos, and the definition of piano is simply that there is a hammer mechanism that hits strings and that creates loud and soft. The main difference is, of course, that this is completely constructed out of wood. This is a wooden frame. It doesn't have iron reinforcement. And iron reinforcement came about gradually when players and instrument makers mutually desired a longer sustaining tone to play in bigger and bigger halls so that you can have thicker strings and you can wind them up with greater tension. So that's one big important difference in construction, and the aesthetic differences, as I've mentioned, the rate of decay of sound. So if I play a tone on this, if I just play middle C, you hear the tone, it dies away very, very quickly. If I do the same on here, same middle C, although this is tuned a little higher. It lasts forever, and it's intended to. So, one of the older notions is that, well, pianos simply progressed and got better, and old instruments became obsolete. Now, that was the standard understanding, roughly speaking, for a long time, until the mid part of the 20th century, when there was a group of instrument builders and musicians who looked toward old instruments and said, hey, there's something, it's not just that they were obsolete or imperfect predecessors to later, more perfected models, this kind of evolutionary perspective, but rather that they were built to do different things. That they were perfect in their own ways, but they intend to do different things. So, an analogy that I often give, which immediately catches this idea, is cars. If you have a Ferrari, it's intended to go very fast, and if you have a small economy car or hybrid, like a Toyota Prius, it's intended to save fuel. Now, of course, you can, you know, drive a Ferrari in New York City traffic and try to race a hybrid car, but you would be going against what these machines were intended to do. And so that's in part this kind of feedback loop that people engaging with early instruments understand, is that while I'm pushing the envelope of this instrument, I'm also listening to what it likes to do and what it was built to do, a set of aesthetic premise, and living inside that premise and then going back to the music to see what other kinds of possible expressive ideas are in the music. The other thing that I didn't mention yet is the pedal. You might have noticed that I was doing funny things with my right knee. This piano does have a normal sustaining pedal mechanism. So of course on the Steinway, everybody would know that the father is right pedal serves that point. So what the pedal does is it lifts up the dampers, what we call the dampers, the mechanism that prevents the strings from vibrating when you don't want them to. When you strike a key, simultaneously the damper lifts So the string is free to vibrate, and when your finger leaves the key, then the damper comes down. And what the pedal does is it lifts all of the dampers at once, allowing this kind of pedal sound. And on Mozart's piano, he had the pedal too. Although at the end of the 18th century, the pedal mechanism wasn't yet put to the floor. That came at the cusp of this century, early 1800s. So what Mozart surely would have done was, as I did, with a knee mechanism to push up. There's a lever here which I push up with my knee, and then all the dampers raise up, the equivalent of my foot pedal. So that says a few things, that of course he used the pedal perhaps less frequently, perhaps in a less refined way. Perhaps the pedal was more of a on and off affair, rather than this kind of late 19th century pedaling where it's sort of imperceptibly always there with refined gradations. So during the course of the evening, I'll tell you more and more about the pianos. Now about Haydn, this next work that I will play by Haydn was written after his second and last trip to London. So for the most part of his life, Haydn worked in rather provincial area of Central Europe. He worked for the Esterházy court, and he was an employer. He had dinner with the cooks and the servants on a long, big, long table. And he was there for the most part of his career, and so he was quite isolated, but that astonishingly didn't limit the scope of his creativity and imagination. And that's one of the most astounding things about Haydn. Mozart, on the other hand, he traveled a lot when he was a kid. His father brought him all over Europe. So Haydn, towards the end of his life, he made two big trips to London, which was then the big metropolis of Europe, big, big cosmopolitan city. And he had two very, very successful trips to London, and this next sonata was written upon the return of his second trip. Now, in London, he came across the English piano. So this is a Viennese piano, so all of the Viennese composers, Mozart, Haydn, Beethoven, Schubert, Schumann, all of these composers played so-called Viennese pianos, and what makes them Viennese is certain action construction, just like what I described. But the English, being English, they had a different way about things. And so they had the so-called English piano with a totally different set, again, different set of goals, different kind of action, different kind of construction. And the aesthetic goal was to make the piano big, fat, and loud, and sustaining. So the English action, in a very, very broad sense, was the line, the lineage that led to the modern piano. So at the turn of the 19th century, late 18th and 19th, there was a bifurcation of piano tradition. There was the British, and then there was the Viennese. And the Viennese action sort of died around the mid-19th century with Brahms. Brahms had one of the late Viennese action pianos, and then nobody makes them anymore because they got too big, too heavy. The whole point of Viennese pianos is they're very, very mobile and very light, as I think you heard. So what's interesting with Haydn is that on those two trips to London, he encountered this different beast. The English piano was much heavier and much louder and more thick. So from that point on, he wrote his keyboard music in quite a different way. So he would have big, heavy chords, and so on and so forth. Now, Haydn himself, unlike Mozart and Beethoven, he wasn't a virtuoso pianist himself. He played the keyboard and he played some string instruments, but he wasn't a big performing virtuoso. What he did, however, was he forged relationships with women pianists. Some of them he fell in love with and had affairs with, but he had these specific women in his life who were, in some cases, tremendously gifted pianists and musicians. And he would dedicate, in important piano works to them. So this next piece, we don't know who he had in mind, but I think the second movement gives you a sense of Haydn's notion of pianism. The first movement is a very interesting movement. It's a sort of a quote-unquote slow movement, although it's not marked as such. The closest equivalent to the first movement would be a jazz number. So it's an improvised movement with the same kind of material coming over, back over and over again, but each time slightly dressed up slightly differently. So the best way to appreciate this next, the first movement of Haydn, is to imagine you're in a kind of 18th century lounge with Haydn sitting there in the corner on the piano, improvising in a kind of jazz improv.
Thank you. Thank you.
I have attended almost all of the Grand Piano Series concerts, and I'm constantly amazed at the artistry of these young pianists that Milana brings in. But what really amazes me beyond that is attending the master classes that they have given for young student pianists here in our area. I am not a pianist, but I get so much from attending these, and I feel the students do. The guest artists are, because they're young, are able to communicate well with the young students here and to be able to get ideas over to them about what they're doing and they're playing. And I also find I get so much from it because I learn so much about the music and find so many things that help me in being able to listen to music when I'm hearing concerts later.
I think the experience was very important. I learned how to approach the music differently. In Beethoven's time, he wrote the music for the pianoforte, and I learned how to try to play that on these modern pianos now. It's an experience.
It helps tremendously to get an experience from another teacher, from someone who's not your own teacher, from someone else. It helps get a new insight on what you're doing. It helps tremendously with your music development.
So you this is that much space. You're playing, the space between chords does not allow me to feel it. Different mentality, but it's still wild people running around. You have general problems with sforzando. They're just hits. They don't have meaning here, especially. So you're tap. Why did he write sforzando? Is it humorous or is it because it can be on purpose, just hit if that's needed for the music. Is this the case? Not sure. So if to me it's rather humorous. So it's rather it's much sharper than just. But this is one of the most weird, one of the weirdest works. Not that many notes in this. What can be weird? Could you? That would be. Yeah. It doesn't make it weird. sound, the picture you're that's in front. I really more and more believe if you are thinking about something else, if you don't have this picture, if this is not the only thing you're that's in your mind at the moment, we can feel it with the audience. So be weird yourself. Don't now you're like, okay, I need to be weird, what should I do? Okay, I just play freely the rhythm. Don't plan this. Just imagine this weird character.
Come, let them know we'd like to see them on Monday.
Thank you.